the unveiling, right? So the curtain's got a study of the book of Revelation from a Christ-centered view. Part 4, Chapter 3, The Three Churches. Before we get started, I wanted to remind you that it would be a good idea if you're watching, especially if you're watching live for the very first time, after the program, I would highly suggest that you go to either the Oasis website. Let me show you here. The Oasis website, www.2oasis.com or mastromin.com. And watch a video, the first video called Rebooting Revelations Part 1, Setting the Atmosphere, where we deal with the structure of not only how the book is written, but more importantly, how some of the tools that we're using to interpret the book of Revelation, and even dealing with some of the challenges. You're going to see one today where there's going to be a Greek textual issue between Greek manuscripts. And the reason for that really is so we can begin to extract a more clear view of what the writer of the book of Revelation was trying to communicate with us. In the preliminary session, also I had recommended to you the Mirror Translation, because some of that Greek lifting, heavy lifting, if you will, was done by the translator of the Mirror Study Bible. And because of that, I was recommending that to folks, because some of the things I'm going to talk about is assuming you've read some of those Greek notes, as well as I'm trying to avoid some of those notes as well and give you another color, another aspect of it. In addition, you're going to find also, because of this approach, some of the things we say may not sound very traditional of the stuff you've heard over the last 100 years or so, if you've been around that long. But the teaching of really the last 100 years in the book of Revelation and how we approach it. Instead, this is probably more first or second century teaching that you're hearing right now. In addition to that, what I want to also bring out to your attention was that when Mirror Word Publishing heard that we were doing this series on their own, really, very gracious of them, they sent me a dozen of the Book of Revelation at a seriously reduced price. Right now, if you went on Amazon just to get the Book of Revelation, it's $25. If you don't have a copy of Revelation, you have maybe an older version of the Mirror, or you don't have the Mirror, and rather than spending the money for the Mirror Bible, which is like three times this thick, Book of Revelation is like a good third of the Mirror translation alone, because of all the amazing footnotes and textual things that is done here. You can get these now through us. I'm not going to announce the price over the phone, but I'm not going to announce the price over, let me try this again. I'm not going to announce the price over the live stream right now, but let's put it this way. If you were to buy it for the $25 on Amazon and you had Amazon Prime and didn't pay for shipping, if I sent it to you priority mail, which is a higher price, and you paid the price here, it would still be a buck or two cheaper than Amazon. So, and actually we don't, of course, have to send it priority mail unless you want it that way. The other thing is, if you're local, it'll even be better for you to maybe meet us and pick up a copy that way, because again, it's significantly less. So having said that, if you don't already have your Mirror Bible out and have read chapter 3, we're going to do that in a minute. Let's get right into the teaching then for today. Father, in Jesus' name, we thank you, Lord, that the Holy Spirit is our teacher. And God, we just lay down preconceived ideas, notions. Lord, we lay down our traditions for a moment and are open to you to allow you to either affirm some of those traditions or maybe take us into a new place, opening to us your heart and mind concerning this incredible book. In Jesus' name, amen. In our last lesson, we discussed the four churches with their progressively degenerative issues as they inadvertently began reincorporating a religious thought life into their liberty of spirituality in Christ. Remember, one of the key significant aspects of chapter one was that Jesus reveals himself as the one who has the seven stars, but we find him not in the starry sky above, but standing among the seven lampstands, aka the ecclesia, we translate churches. In other words, one of the key central aspects of the book of Revelation is that Christ is to be seen, heard, and felt through the ecclesia. Amen? This is about the incarnation of Christ, revealed through his people who have responded to his call. Yet, there are some problems obscuring the fullness of that incarnation, and those who at first responded to the call found themselves, rather than revealing Christ, returning to old religious and political systems. With that, let's review the first four churches real quick. So here would be our first church. Ephesus. He sees their exhausting efforts, but their legalistic efforts to attain and maintain their connection to God obscure it. It wasn't that Christ left them, but they abandoned the very essence of the gospel in their thinking. They divorced their first love. In addition, as this kind of thinking arises, it creates a hierarchy known as the Nicolaitan, which in effect controls people through religious fear, and the people welcome it. It's amazing how we like that to occur in our lives in some cases. We like the idea, we may not admit it, but the ego likes the idea of being a bit afraid of God just in case he gets angry. Think of all the religious systems, especially in the West, the Roman religious system with Jupiter, who is their head god, or Zeus, who's the head god of the Greeks. And you can go down some of the other religious systems as you move on into the East. But if you think about them, how many times people would just sacrifice because they were afraid? How many times they would do things because they'd be afraid maybe their crops wouldn't be blessed this year? So the fear was a tremendous amount of a part of religious thought, whether we know it or not. How many people are afraid of false doctrine? It's a culture of fear. Amen? Well, from Ephesus, who is a church of works, we now move to Smyrna. Like Ephesus, Smyrna is also a very religious work-based community. Yet their legalisms have taken them to another level of religiosity. They've become boxed into a tight space spiritually. One of the attributes of Smyrna is religious intoxication. Remember, the word Smyrna comes from myrrh, and myrrh, though a nice perfume when ingested, is a pretty heavy narcotic. Their system of belief has them intoxicated to the point they claim to associate with worshipers of God, but they are actually connecting themselves to the synagogue of Satan. And remember, Satan here in Jewish thought, the Hasatan, is anything adverse to God. It's not necessarily a particular picture of maybe what we've thought of Satan in the West. It's way broader than that. Okay, and the very fact that the gospel of grace and faith is the message of Christ, when we get into fear and religious works, we are now Hasatan. We are contrary. We are adverse to the message. Make sense? Okay. Having said that, let's go from Smyrna now to Pergamos. Pergamos, taking the Smyrna condition to the next level, they are not just fellowshipping with the synagogue of Satan, they are taking residence at the headquarters. From works and the hierarchy of the Nicolaitans to intoxicated religious thinking, now they are attempting to marry, which is the word Pergamos, marry the gospel of the kingdom to Balak through a type of Balaam. In other words, marry the kingdom of God to the political system of the day through the prophetic. This is now called an accepted doctrine. It's important to note that the word Balaam in Hebrew means Lord of the people. The full manifestation of the Nicolaitan doctrine, which was to control the people or conquer the people, is fulfilled when the prophetic rules the people. In the church, we are a family, and there are some responsible roles of authority to mature the saints people have, but controlling and ruling do not foster maturity. They actually hinder it. So I want you to think about this idea here when we talked about this last time a little bit, the marrying of the gospel to religiosity and political system at the same time, or either or. The point is, this is how then control happens and ruling people happen. And one of the aspects, and I believe the really transcendent truths, is that we have a propensity to do this over and over again. I think we just saw a major fiasco of that in our own election, where prophets were prophesying things and they blew it. Okay? So we got to be very careful in how we do this. On to church number four, Thyatira. From an inappropriate marriage of the gospel, religion, and politics, now we're in bed with an extreme expression of control and rule, the whoredom of Jezebel. This is no longer just called headquarters, but now the deep things of Satan. In Thyatira, we go from being boxed by intoxication to, quote, confinement with great anguish. We return to a ritual sacrificial system. Jesus says, the offspring of these mindsets conceived in your licentious idolatry has no future. At the conclusion of Thyatira's message, rather than telling them to hear and follow by promise, remember that's how it went. He would say, hear what the Spirit says in the churches, and then he'd add a promise. Something else happens. He states the promise first and then declares on no uncertain terms, hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches. It flips. It appears the emphasis has changed to saying, now, stop and listen to what is being said. There's a greater concern here. As we now move toward the last three of the ecclesia, the called out ones, Pastor Karen is going to come and read to us chapter 3. Next time we get together, whoever's going to read chapter 4 gets off easy because it's only half the verses. So, but today, Pastor Karen, if you would.
Sorry.
Revelation chapter 3. And to the messenger of the ecclesia in Sardis write, he who holds the seven spirits of God and the seven stars in resonance says, I see your toil, but there is a big difference between dead works and vibrant life. Awake from your slumber. Get a firm grip on what little life you have left in you. Your work does not mirror my finished work. Remember, therefore, what it felt like when you first heard and embraced the word as your own. It was like discovering a priceless treasure. Now make up your mind once and for all. Why should I surprise you like a thief and break into your space whilst you are fast asleep and not even anticipating my intimate intent, not knowing the moment of my visitation? You do have a few individual names in Sardis who have not forgotten their true identity and soiled their garments. They are those who walk with me in innocence and who mirror the reference of their worth to be equal to my estimate of them. Everyone who sees their victory in me, I will clothe in white garments, and they will realize that I am not in the business of fulfilling their law and performance-based fears by blotting out their names from the book of life. Instead, I am the one who endorses their identity face to face before my Father and his shepherd messengers. Now listen up with your inner ears. Hear with understanding what the Spirit is saying to the ecclesia. And to the messenger of the ecclesia of Philadelphia write, I am the holy and true one. I hold the key of David. Yes, I unlock the mysteries of the heavenly dimension, and no one can shut the door. And I lock the entrance, and none of the old mindsets can access it. I am fully aware of your efforts in doing the work of the ministry. I want you to see something. I have given you a doorway right in front of you that has been fully opened into the heavenly dimension. Nothing can possibly close it again. Even when you had very little strength, you have treasured my word and have not contradicted my name. Behold, the Jewish disguise will be exposed to be the synagogue of Satan. They have sourced their gatherings in accusation, but now I give them to you and will cause them to come face to face with you in fellowship, in acknowledgement of my love, which I have bestowed upon you. You have greatly valued the prophetic word which came to fulfillment in what I endured. I will also guard you with great care, empowering you to stand strong in the midst of the troubled times that are about to come upon the inhabited world to scrutinize the dwellers of the earth. Do not let tough times make me seem distant from you. I am at hand. See my nearness, not my absence. And don't let temporal setbacks diminish your own authority either. Remember that you call the shots. You wear the crown. My crown endorses your crown. It is in your individual, continual association with your victory in me that I will make you to be like a strong pillar in the inner shrine of God's sanctuary, supporting the entire structure of my God habitation within you, a place to be your permanent abode from whence you will never have to depart. And I will engrave upon you the name of my God, also the name of the city of my God, the new Jerusalem that descends from heaven, as well as my own new name. Now listen up with your inner ears. Hear with understanding what the Spirit is saying to the Ecclesia. And to the shepherd of the Ecclesia in Laodicea write, he who speaks is the Amen. He is the ultimate evidence and the one who defines faith. He personifies the truth. She is the very source of God's creation. I am familiar with your works, and you remind me of the typical situation in Laodicea. How I wish that your lives were like the cold, refreshing waters of Colossae or like the waters of the healing thermal springs of Hierapolis. But they are neither cold nor hot. This is what really disappoints. When you anticipate a refreshing cool drink, but instead get a mouthful of lukewarm, sulfur-tasting water, you would naturally spit it out. As your name suggests, you are experts in justifying yourselves. You are convinced that you have all your ducks in a row. Your plumbing is sorted. Your trade and economy are thriving industries. You think that you are completely independent, yet you have no idea of how bankrupt you really are. Your entire economy is flawed since you are trading with monopoly money. It is fake currency. Your scales are rigged. If only you knew how desperately in need you are of someone to show you tender compassion and mercy. I mean, look at you. On the outside, you may appear to be standing tall and proud in your self-righteousness, but in reality, you are in a pitiful state. You are like a crouching, cringing beggar. Your smoke screen has blinded your view. You think you're hiding in your fancy brand name clothes, but you don't realize how naked and exposed you are. I invite you to talk business with me. Come, let us resolve this together. I want to make you really rich. I advise you to buy gold from me, gold that is thoroughly refined in the fire, not the flawed currency of your own trade. We're not talking a mixture here, no dross. And from now on, buy your clothing from me, white garments, not the blended brand of your own making. Clothe yourself completely with these, and there will not even be a hint of shame. For your eyes, buy eye salve from me to anoint your eyes so that you may clearly see yourself in Christ. It is with affection that I address every one of you, whoever you are. I would earnestly persuade you as a parent would instruct and nurture their children. Eagerly acquaint yourself with all that I have in mind for you. You have shut me out in your self-righteousness, but behold, here I stand knocking at the door. If anyone recognizes my voice and lets me in, I am so ready to join you for a feast. Yes, I will dine with you and you with me. And everyone's personal triumph will be celebrated together with me by being jointly seated together in my kingship. It is on exactly the same basis of my victory celebration and my joint seatedness with my Father in his throne room. Now listen up with your inner ears. Hear with understanding what the Spirit is saying to the Ecclesia. The Mirror Translation.
Wow. Excellent. That's a reader, huh? Mile knows what I mean by that is he is now editing my reading of the Melchizedek book. Poor boy. Some may not believe in purgatory, but I think he may feel like he's there. Of these churches, the first is called Sardis. In Sardis, Christ appears, this time not only holding the seven stars, but also the seven spirits of God, and says, I see your toil, but there is a big difference between dead works and vibrant life. Sardis was a luxury city. It was the capital of Lydia, not only known for the materials, made with scarlet, but also for its material, or actually its ore, called electrum, which is called white gold. The coins of Lydia were made with the king's emblem, which was a roaring lion. If you start thinking of other symbologies and things we find in the Book of Revelation, especially those of you who've been around for a bit and have read the Book of Revelation, you know that now some of these symbologies that Jesus is going to be speaking of are reflective of where they are and what's going on. It was situated at the base of Mount Tmolus, and from it came the river Proctolus, which was said to have gold dust in it. Now, Tmolus was the god who judged the musical competition between Apollo and Pan. Now, kind of get this picture for a minute. Who's Apollo? We know Apollo usually as the sun god that rides the chariot. Pan was a demigod of the forest who looked a lot like what we've later described as Satan, with the curled horns and the beast-like legs from the waist down, and he played what we know as the panpipes. It's like a flute. Apollo was declared the winner unanimously by all who attended the competition except one, Pan's good friend Midas. Midas touch, what was the Midas touch? Remember that? The Midas touch, gold finger. He's the man with the Midas touch. What is it? Anything that Midas would touch would turn to gold. So now if you think of this mountain and this river with the gold dust, you kind of see how this is the situation here. And later with Jesus, because all these churches are in close proximity to each other, you hear Jesus talking about buying gold refined by fire. You hear all these things. So you kind of get the backdrop to whom he's speaking. What's interesting also is when Midas chose Pan, Apollo, in one of the stories, there's several different outcomes based on how the story goes, but Pan always lost, and it was always unanimous that Apollo won, except for this one vote by Midas. In one particular story, I thought was kind of interesting because it made me think of Walt Disney's Pinocchio, and that's that because Midas didn't hear the music the same way as everybody else, Apollo gave Midas the ears of a donkey, saying, hopefully you could hear better next time. Made me think of that island where the kids were having all the pleasures and they began turning into donkeys as the time went on. Another thing about Apollo at this point, a little side note, he presided over archery, music, poetry, philosophy, education, medicine, and of course was the sun god. Just so happens to equal 7. There's probably something else that you can throw in to make 8, but I just found it interesting in the list of his things, it was 7, and now Jesus shows up with the 7 spirits of God. Now, for what it's worth, in Plato's day, each city had its own theater made up of town locals. They were the actors. And sometimes it'd even be a turnover. You know, some folks would act in some plays and other folks would act, and it would all be done within the local town. There was no big stars, let's say, you know, like in Hollywood, where they're international actors in Greece at the time. It was basically local volunteer actors. But the poet philosophers would travel into the cities, writing and directing their plays. At the end of the series of performances, interestingly enough, a golden statue of Apollo would be given to the actor that made the most impact. We've kept that tradition today, only changing the name from Apollo to Oscar.
Wow.
It's important to note that the 7 spirits of God are later defined in chapter 5, I'll show you in just a minute, as the horns and eyes of the Lamb. These, again, are branches to describe spiritual roots. Like in the book of Genesis, there's actually one day with 6 attributes, thus listing 7 days. The first day is the all-encompassing expression. The other 6 give the attributes or aspects of the whole. The same applies here. In the book of Isaiah, we see these listed in primal form. Now first, let's look at Revelation 5. Of course, we'll go there later on. I saw a little lamb alive and standing, even though it seemed to have been violently butchered in sacrifice. It had seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God, having been sent out to accomplish his bidding in all the earth. So we get a further definition now of what the seven spirits of God is as the book of Revelation progresses. And you're going to find, in many respects, as the book of Revelation progresses, many of these principles and concepts that are spoken about in the first chapter, then reiterated in chapters 2 and 3 through the aspect of the seven churches or the seven ecclesia, are then repeated throughout the book of Revelation till we reach its final conclusion in the 22nd chapter. Now, in Isaiah, that's this here, we see a listing of, quote, the seven spirits of God. The spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, and the spirit of knowledge and the fear of the Lord. Now, to itemize them, and we'll do that in a minute, but they count them as the spirit of the Lord is the all-encompassing one, right? Then you have the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge, and the fear or reverence of the Lord. So there's your seven. In Sardis' condition, they move beyond a Thyatira return to sacrificing to a complete spiritual deadness. They have no spiritual life, though on the surface they appear alive and fruitful. Consider that way of thinking for a minute, that idea, because how many times, and his warning is how self-deceiving we can be, thinking we're spiritually prosperous when actually maybe we've departed from a central aspect or another aspect of the gospel of Jesus Christ. I'm not talking about the story. I'm talking about the emanation of the gospel in our lives. Remember, we talked about that in the first session. We're not talking about how well we know the story of Jesus. That could be equally deceiving if I'm not emanating what that gospel produces, if I'm not emanating what that gospel is speaking. And that was some of the challenge here. If we continue, it's important to point out the seven spirits of God are later, again, defined as the horns and eyes of the Lamb, right? Again, these are branches to describe spiritual roots. So let's take a look at those now in Hebrew for a moment, and I'm going to just point out a couple of things for you. These are now the seven spirits of God. It's Ruach Yahweh, Ruach Chokmah, Ruach Bina, Ruach Etzah, Ruach Gevura, Ruach Da'at, and Ruach Ra'et. They are, and consider, okay, what these words now are implying to us and how they're going to fit this story. Let's quickly encircle a few of these, if you don't mind. We have these three that are quite specific, and then the fourth one. I'm not going to go through all seven today. But the Chokhmah, Bina, Da'at, and Etzah are the ones for wisdom, understanding, knowledge, and then counsel. The one circled in kind of the reddish brown color is counsel. I'll talk about that in a minute. Now, if you remember in the first chapter, we had this, and we talked about, again, the sevens that were there, and this shield of David, and how our Jewish brothers and sisters extract certain ideas from this. Once again, we have three on the top, three on the bottom, and one in the center there. That's, again, seven. Well, if I add Chokhmah, Bina, and Da'at up at the top, I will now have what in Jewish mysticism is called the Tree of Life. Okay? So it's all there in the text, in many respects, in the Book of Revelation. But what I wanted to do is just take a moment to talk about Chokhmah, Bina, and Da'at, or wisdom, understanding, and knowledge. In modern, our order or priority is usually knowledge, understanding, and then wisdom. You may remember that we've done this through Genesis Factor. Knowledge is the ability to use facts. Understanding is the ability to prioritize them, and wisdom is the ability to use them. In Hebraic thought, they're very different. First actually comes wisdom, second understanding, and third is knowledge. Okay? One of the best ways I heard explained was like this. So first, let's take a look at wisdom. What is wisdom? Wisdom is like a flowing stream, constantly in motion, never ending like God's eternal thoughts. It's constantly in motion. Understanding is like scooping a handful of water from the flowing stream where you can grasp what is there. This is wonderful, and yet the moment we scoop, we're no longer in the flow. And must be cognizant that there is always more in the flow. And then finally, we have knowledge. And on purpose, that's not a moving picture. Knowledge is similar to ingesting the understanding gained, which is wonderful. However, knowledge is stagnated. It is completely out of the flow. That's why at any point, what we know can reform itself into the knowledge of the serpentine tree of good and evil. The tree of life is always rooted in the river of life proceeding from the throne, Revelation 22:2. Thus, what I like to say is, regarding drinking this water, let knowledge run through you, just like water. Never fixate or get stuck on it. Enjoy the know, but stay in the flow. That's kind of important. Another way God shared with me some years ago was live in the fade. Live in the fade. I'm sure we've all seen wonderful television programs on how, you know, or movies, how many times they start, and there's actually an art to this, where they would start not immediately in a, let's say, somebody's office. Let's say the Daily Planet, if we're watching a Superman movie or something, or a Superman television show. Instead, it would start with seeing the city from a distance and the Daily Planet off in the distance. And then it would fade into the shot. The thing is if we are going to live in wisdom, we've got to live in the fade, the ever-changing picture. The second you hold on to the scene that you have, so to speak, it immediately becomes that of the past and no longer forward-looking. We have trouble migrating to where we're going. Many times that is fear-based again, because what I know I don't want to let go of, because what I know many times frames my belief in my picture of reality. Which then brings me to the fourth word there, the ruach etzah, which is this, interestingly enough. Etzah, counsel, is the same word for tree. It's an issue of what tree are you observing? Because the other aspect of etzah is that it also means to close the eyes. And if you remember in the teaching we've done with Genesis factors, the power or the concept behind the tree of knowledge of good and evil and the tree of life is that you can't behold both at the same time. You're either open to one and closed to the other, or you're open to the other and closed to the one. And no different when Jesus says you can't serve two masters. That's important because the eyes of the lamb have their root in the tree of life. And because of that, remember we've just mentioned that tree of life is rooted in Revelation 22:2. And again, we're just catapulted to the end of the book, so to speak, but there's tremendous continuity here. And the point being, and as this relates to Sardis, is what have they become? What are they beholding? They're no longer beholding tree of life. Which now brings us to this point. Jesus calls them to awake from the death sleep. He adds, their works do not mirror his finished work. Because his finished work is rest. Thank you, Lord. Resting in the nature of God, not just external from you, but the nature of God within you. Thank you. I don't have to work at attaining it. The book of Hebrews says it quite interestingly. labor to enter into rest. That's kind of a funny way of saying it, but because the ego has such a, what the apostles also called the flesh, has such a way of always wanting to achieve some kind of spirituality by its works or rituals. The only way the apostle can explain it there is, okay, labor to enter into rest. In other words, you're going to have to work at resting. And I don't know about you, there's a truth to that I know in my life, especially when it comes to ministry, et cetera. And, you know, when you don't necessarily have a staff of 15 people and all this stuff like some larger ministries, when you are, as my wife would say, the preacher, the chief bottle washer, the toilet bowl cleaner, when you do all those things sometimes, and many times throughout the years we've done all those things. I mean, thank God for those who have helped over the years. But the point is in doing that, many times, you know, you can get so busy, you don't even know how to rest anymore. Right. Sometimes, notice how it works, because this is now about a good and evil things. People feel guilty when they rest. How many times, when it comes to the things of God, we don't even realize it, but we feel guilty because resting in faith seems like you're doing nothing. It's hard to grasp when we're asleep or even groggy coming out of sleep that our works in any form are still in the realm of death. As stated in Hebrews 6, we must change our thinking away from dead works. And for that matter, what is a dead work? A dead work is anything done apart from our true identity. To put it another way, a dead work is anything done by the ego. In contrast, anything born of love isn't a dead work, but a living joy. In this chapter, there is one of those textual language issues that should be addressed, and it particularly appears in verse 5 with Sardis. And back in 2019, I did a weekly broadcast called Seeds from the Tree of Life. And in Seeds from the Tree of Life, one of the things I did was address textual issues because it was geared for those who wanted to expand their understanding of how the Bible is structured, let alone what's in the Bible, and for leaders, for those who wanted to expand in leadership of understanding concerning some of these things. So in this one episode, it was called Revelation, Jesus, and the Bible. I expounded on Revelation chapter 3, verse 5. Here's that video. Chapter 3, verse 5 from the Textus Receptus, the King James Bible reads it this way. He that overcomes, or King James would actually say, he that overcometh, the same shall be clothed in white raiment, and I will not blot out his name out of the book of life, but I will confess his name before my Father and before his angels. Well, once again, here's an interesting phrase, I will confess. The Greek word there, as you see highlighted on your screen, is exomolegosmai. And exomolegosmai means I will proclaim. Once again, Textus Receptus. You remember, going back a few weeks now, what the Textus Receptus was about. The Textus Receptus was a translation. The idea was to get an authentic Greek translation of the New Testament. However, there were parts that were missing, and what our friend Erasmus did is go back to the Latin Vulgate, the Catholic edition, and simply translate from there. So this word means I will proclaim. Well, the issue is now, once again, it almost seems to imply that I have to overcome something, and then once I overcome it, then Christ will proclaim. Now, once again, think about it. How is that any different than saying, in effect, if I keep the commandments, I'll enter the tree of life? It isn't. That's the problem. It isn't. It's no different at all. What do you mean? I'm going to overcome, then I'll be clothed in white raiment, then my name doesn't get blotted out of the book of life, and then Christ will confess my name before his Father. Up until that, it's like Jesus isn't talking, which we know is not true. If you think about the book of Hebrews, it talks about how the blood of Christ spoke more excellent things than even that of Abel, which cried out to God from the ground. So think of that for a minute. So Christ, his sacrifice and resurrection, speaks.
So how can he be kind of holding out on you until you get it right? Which again is a works-based, commandment-based mindset. Actually, again, if we go to the Westcott Hort and take a look at that, and this is the New Century version. First of all, again, there's a significant difference. Now we're going to change exomolegosmai and putting it back to homologizo. And homologizo is different. Homologizo really shows us what Jesus was saying. Homo means together as one. I mean, we've used that word for other things. Homogeneous, for example. Homo, one. Okay, together. And logos not only means to say, but if you remember, logos is the divine thought. We translate the word of God. In the beginning was the word. The word was with God, right? That phrase, and the word was God. Logos, the divine thought, the divine imagination that creates all things. So by changing that to homologizo, it changes the picture. This, it reads this way. Those who win the victory will be dressed in white clothes like them. And I will not erase their names from the book of life, but I will say they belong to me before my Father and before his angels. Now, again, I will say they belong to me. Well, that's closer. Jesus is associating something here in his words. But of course, we have these other things, those who win the victory. What am I winning the victory over? If you remember, the context of Revelation 3 is leaving the world of works and moving back into the revelation of Christ as Redeemer within us. He's brought us back and opened a pathway for us to understand our identity and kingdom reign. That's what he's done. That's what Christ has done. He's restoring our identity back, that we can let go of the ideas of I'm not like God enough, but instead I am way more than like God enough because I was created in his image and likeness, and Christ restores that thinking to us. All we need to do, if there's anything, is accept the fact that it's true. Just correct our thinking. That's where the victory is. It's here. So the way to wrap this up would be for this section is really not I will say they belong to me as much as, and I am at one thought in name face to face with my Father. And I am at one thought in name and face with my Father. In other words, Jesus is not just saying I will say they belong. I'm saying we're one. We're one thought before the face of my Father. And Father, consider this. Jesus tells us, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father, right? Well, in a sense, what Jesus is saying to the Father, if you've seen me, you see them.
Well, you could just park it right there and end with that notion. Wow. If you've seen me, Father, you've seen them. It's so simple. But it's in my notes to say that, actually. Jesus concludes stating that there are few who have not forgotten their true identity, rooted in his view of them. Isn't that awesome? That's the point. It's so simple, and yet in some respects, it's so difficult or stupid. Our identity is rooted in how God sees us. Yet we fight and resist that view because the ego refuses to relinquish control. The ego says, who God wants me to be is still out of my grasp until we pursue more righteous things. Thus, we're not there yet. That old dog chasing his tail kind of thing. How do you pursue to be more righteous if you're not? In the economy of God, it's you are righteous, therefore you just can relax and be who you are. And of course, that's the context of righteousness that we spoke of last time. But we would rather hold on to an illusion of ourselves that says we're less than, rather than the universal, eternal, transcendent reality of who we are as God decreed it. Isn't that true? Well, now on to Philadelphia. It's interesting that the name Philadelphia simply means, really, love your brother. brotherly love, all different ways that we have used it. It's so simple, it's almost mindless. This is the simple expression of the gospel of Christ. Love your fellow man. Religion says, love those who believe like you and have a condescending pity on those who are not so enlightened. But not so in Christ. He sees all within himself. Christ is, hear me, the Son of Man. That's John 6:61, John 8:28. Now consider this. Jesus says in John 8:23, right between those two statements of Son of Man, matter of fact, just a few verses before one, he says this, speaking to the Pharisees, you are from beneath, I am from above. You are of this world, I'm not of this world. What does that mean regarding his origin and ours? Now, on the one scale, you would say, well, he's from above, and we're from here. No. It's talking about mindsets, really. He is the Son of Man. Man's origin, regardless of what we think about it, is also from above. It's our belief about ourselves that places us in something else. When speaking of this ecclesia, Jesus says he holds the key of David, which unlocks the mysteries of the heavenly dimension. The key of David is unique. It means the right, permission, or privilege to open something that seemed to be shut. Quote, yes, I unlock the mysteries of the heavenly dimension, and no one can shut the door. My works can't shut the door. My failures can't shut the door. Amen. But there is an issue. Herein is the point. If we let go of fear, if we let go of the slavery of moral correctness, we can use the key that Christ freely gives to us. It's not about if we do this, he will do that. God has delivered us from the suzerain vassal covenant that Israel redefined at Sinai. You see, up until Sinai, we had what was called a grant covenant. A grant covenant, that's what happened with Abraham. A grant covenant is basically, you don't have to do anything, just receive what I'm trying to give you. And if you go back and look at Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, there was never a sin sacrifice. They were never sacrificing to try to get a blessing. It was God just saying, take actually, kind of like the father to the two sons, take your inheritance. It's yours. But what happened at Sinai, mind you, you have a grant covenant. Israel decides to change the terms of the covenant. And because God is in a grant covenant, he grants them that. And now they're in a vassal covenant, meaning it's tit for tat. You obey the rules, you get blessed. You don't obey the rules, you get cursed. And if you break the rules, somebody's got to pay for it. None of this was in God's scheme of things. If you remember the story, actually, when Israel shows up at Sinai, and by the way, Sinai, the word means hated, okay? Sinai, when they show up there, God starts to talk. He's just talking. And because of the flashings and the thunderings, Israel turns around and goes, I'm not sure about this. Right. How about Moses, you go up that mountain. Yeah. We're going to stay here. Yeah. You find out what God says, then you come back and tell us, and we'll obey it all. Well, we know how that worked out. He's up the mountain, and no sooner that he's up the mountain, they're doing stuff down there to the point where they take all the prosperity and blessing they left Egypt with, all the gold earrings and all that stuff, and they throw it into a big pot, and Aaron, who fashions, it says, he actually creates a golden calf, and they name it Yahweh. And now they're worshiping the golden calf, Yahweh. That should tell us something. The second we depart from an intimacy with God by the Spirit in his nature, all of a sudden, it may have the same name. You may be wearing the t-shirt that says the right name, you know, have a Bible that says his name. But guess what? It's a golden calf. Of course, by the time Moses comes down, and as a result, by this is going on simultaneously, they both go hand in glove. They're now getting their commandments. They're now going to get their vassal covenant. This, here you go. Here it is. Well, Moses don't get down the mountain to the point that he's not even down the mountain yet, and he's breaking the tablets. Why? He's angry. Commandments and anger always go together, according to the apostle in Romans. Okay, so now we have this thing called the anger of God and all this stuff which we've talked about before, which is not any aspect of the nature of God, but the commandment produced that. Thus, the sacrificial system and all this stuff is instituted. And hey, it's like, okay, we're going to play tit for tat. Here we go. And yet the whole time God is trying to work through, it says in the fullness of time Christ came, he's trying to get us back to a grant covenant because that's his nature. In the end game, as he's doing all this, you know, he comes down the mountain and he says to Aaron, which to me is always the funny part of that verse, that section of scripture in Exodus, he says, what happened? And Aaron goes, I don't know, we just threw the gold in and out came a calf. How convenient. Christ says that because of their love walk, the legalists, if you remember back what we just heard read, Christ says because of their love walk, the legalistic righteousness of the synagogue of Satan will come and worship face to face with them. Now, in traditionally as translated, will worship before your feet. Now, when we first hear that, we think of groveling now. And yeah, I'm superior, you're not, you blew it, etc. But understand something. The notion of worshiping at one's feet is an expression of ascension when experiencing a theophany. That's taken right out of the Theological Dictionary of the New Testament by Kittel and Friedrich in the section called Comparative Religions. So it wasn't that they're groveling as much as they've come face to face with a theophany. And they are now ascending into that place. That's why, if you notice what Francois did in the translation of Mary, he talked about meeting face-to-face. Because that word there, by the way, what's come before, the word before, there's quite a few different Greek words, some related, some not, of the word before. That particular means literally to see face-to-face. So it's kind of interesting then, but because of that, it's good to know some of those ideas. In that light, there was a verse at this point that just rang out to me in chapter 3, I just wanted to let it speak to us during these challenging times, just to listen to it. And I found it interesting when Pastor Karen got up earlier and began to speak. She was moved to have us say some things, et cetera. And I just thought maybe the Spirit is, if we don't get anything else today, maybe this is what the Spirit of God is trying to communicate. Check this verse out. Verse 11. Do not let tough times make me seem distant from you. Hallelujah. I'm at hand. See my nearness, not my absence. And don't let temporal setbacks diminish your own authority either. Remember that you call the shots. You wear the crown. My crown endorses your crown. Amen. I mean, that's like, wow. Thinking on that for a minute. I love that. Don't let tough times make me see distant from you. The Philadelphia church, whether from a religious or spiritual view, has gotten many positives. But herein is the simplicity of creation. If you love your brother, you are emanating Christ, whether you are conscious of Christ or not. It's, say, well, they haven't received Jesus. You're already created in the image and likeness of God. So even when you love somebody, let's say by accident, you don't realize, you don't. When I say by accident, it's not even accident. People genuinely love other people, and they're doing that. Whether it's family, the neighbor, and I don't care what religious system you are in. Doesn't matter. The second we're helping our neighbor, feeding the hungry, doing all those things, it's irrelevant of what label you wear. That is still an aspect of the nature of God. Loving yourself or loving someone else is still an attribute of God, whether you prayed the sinner's prayer or not. With this in mind, let me suggest this. Because of what Christ has done, there is no more separation, loss, failure, or sin. This can be difficult for the religious mind to grasp, but sin, whatever that means to you in your life, because many of us have different definitions of what that means and how we apply it to ourselves so we can stay guilty. Okay? Sin, whatever that means to you, is no longer a force in the equation. Christ has marginalized it to the point of insignificance. These things only exist in our egoistic, serpentine fears, sense of separation, performance orientation, and religious legalism. They do not exist in the mind of the Father, Son, and Spirit. Period. Now, many times we've done things as human beings to one another and to ourselves because we've lost consciousness of that reality. And let's face it, most of us aren't very conscious many of the times. Even some of us that know, quote unquote, Christ, we lose consciousness. I heard one person say it this way. I'd like to say this too in light of this as we go on to the final church now. Consider this. When Jesus said, Father, forgive them, they don't know what they're doing, apply it to yourself. Now you would think, well, wait a minute. They plotted, they paid for, they conspired with the Romans for the crucifixion of Jesus. And yet, from a God view, they don't know what they're doing. They were unconscious, they weren't aware of who they were, who God was, and of course, who Christ was then at that moment. Apply it to yourself if next time you do something stupid. Which now brings us to the last ecclesia, Laodicea. Christ appears as the Amen, the conclusion of the question and the evidence of divine definition. He personifies truth, and she is the source of God's creation. I love the fact that because of our union of relationship and what this all means. Now, first of all, some history. Laodicea, formerly known as Diospolis, which is means city of Zeus, like all other block logic definitions, is the culmination of the six previous churches. It was one of the key cities that mined and sent gold, get a load of this now, to the building of the temple in Jerusalem. All previous churches can be defined as a progression of falling away from the gospel of grace and faith, a return to laws, rituals, and sacrifice. The progression, in summary, without mentioning the church's names, goes like this. By comparison now. So this is what Jesus is telling us really not to embrace. Not works, not by our intoxication with right and wrong, most definitely not our marriage to religion and politics, nor our sacrifices, whether blood or service, to finally have an external practice of performance, but to be internally dead in the delusion of the death sleep. Rather, it's Philadelphian. Loving your human brothers and sisters in whatever way unveils Christ. And then it all culminates at Laodicea. He expounds, transcending all generations, that the average status of so-called Christian people is in flux. They are Laodicea, meaning people needing to make a decision. It's not that hot or cold is bad or good or vice versa. It's about what it means to be lukewarm, to be in a place of indecision. Understand, hot or cold were both good things. if you're going to, it was still life-giving in the mind of God. We think hot or cold as well. Hot must be, I'm hot for Jesus. I'm not cold for Jesus. That's not the context. That's why, and I appreciated that the mirror inserted the waters of Colossae in comparison to the healing springs of Hierapolis. Okay, the two was, the waters of Colossae were very clean and very refreshing. So that's the water you wanted to use, for example, to cook with and to drink. On the other hand, you had the healing springs, the sulfur-type springs, kind of like up at Lake Arrowhead, okay? You have those that you would get in medicinally. So if you think about it, you could be sitting in the hot springs for your medical condition while you're drinking some cool water at the same time from the other river. Okay? The problem is when you mingle the two and you try to drink, guess what happens? You throw up. This was the point really Jesus was making. It's not about right or wrong, good or evil. It's about trying to mingle. Remember, we're just coming off, mingling the gospel, Pergamos. We're coming off of trying to merge the old way of paganism and sacrifice and ritual to this gospel. And he says, when you do that, you're always in a place of indecision. Make a decision. Take a cool drink or get in a hot tub. But either way, come on. I thought that's pretty powerful. He continues in Laodicea, such are experts in justifying themselves. They appear to have everything in place, but from Christ's point of view, it's spiritually bankrupt. Though the Laodicea believe they are interacting, buying and selling with truth appropriately, it's still all monopoly money. I like the paraphrase that he uses there to try to describe what the text is saying. A fake currency. The challenge with the Laodicean mentality is that it is so right in its own eyes in theology, practice, politics, it can't honestly see truth, because to be truthful would mean to have to be honest with myself. And the challenge all of us have when we become brutally honest about us and how we're viewing something is that many times when it comes to be in line with the gospel, it kicks the scaffolding out from underneath of whatever is making me feel right or making me feel wrong. Championing the cause or being afraid of one. It kicks the scaffolding out. Rather than that, they choose with the absolute certainty of lukewarm. I am so certain. I've entered into lukewarmness rather than resting. Because if you think about both of those pictures, whether you're drinking cool water or sitting in a hot tub made of, you know, sulfur salts, it's an act of resting or refreshing, as opposed to I have to work at mixing the two. Right. Now, the root of the name Laodicean means self-righteous people. On the surface, it's people that need to make a decision, but it's still rooted in our self-righteousness. Now consider, Jesus implores this mindset to buy reality from him. While all this time, the Laodicean mindset believe all is well with God, Christ is outside knocking on the door hoping to be allowed in. Right? Now think of this. I thought this was a very, you know, the wit of the inspired writers by the Holy Spirit when it comes to this stuff. Consider, the old King James is, behold, I stand at the door and knock. Right. And if anyone would hear my voice and let me in, right?
Right.
But what did Jesus just start? I hold the keys.
Right.
And open a door that nobody could shut.
Right.
But now I got a shut door. How'd that happen? Only in Hebraic block logic can you have such things. Because if you follow it from a Western point of view, the logic doesn't meet up really. How can you have a key that opens everything and nobody can shut? And now I got a door I'm banging on for letting, please let me in, please, please. Or come out, one of us, just can we meet? The real issue is he's got the keys, remember, that unlocks the divine realities of the throne room. Right. Yet I still stand before the two trees with choice. Okay, do I turn the key with him? Right. Or do I keep my hand off the key and the door stays shut? And because it's a grant covenant, if you want to keep the door shut? What came to my mind, actually, when I was writing this, made me think of Hunt for Red October and some of those submarine movies, but particularly the movie Hunt for Red October when, of course, the great Sean Connery was in that. And he, was this Russian, was he an admiral or whatever their rank was of the submarine, but it was a nuclear submarine. And the thing was, two people had to turn, put their keys in and turn in order for the thing to unlock and be used. And I couldn't help but think of the same thing. Jesus has got us the keys. We've all been handed these keys. It's all ours. And yet, the place of indecision, the lukewarm place, is almost like staring at the key saying, I got it, there's the door and the lock, and I hear a guy pounding. And all I need to do is turn the key and open the door. But herein again is the kind of aspect of the gospel. Christ's work is finished. Everything's been afforded to us. Everything. Just like in the Garden of Eden. But we will always have the choice whether we can enter in or not. The key is, pun intended, that we will always be co-laborers with Christ. In the same way that his victory is our victory, our discovery of our divine identity is his unveiling in humanity as well. Think of that. See, truth, aletheia, the unveiling. While we're trying to think of, Christ has come and revealed, yet that revealing happens as we unveil. Jesus concludes with this statement, and everyone's personal triumph will be celebrated together with me by being jointly seated together in my kingship. He concludes with the reiteration that we are all together. One's triumph is everyone's triumph. All to be celebrated together in his kingship. Amen? Amen. Praise the Lord.
Yes, yes, yes.
Now, in certain respects, we could just park there and say that was the book of Revelation because it unveiled. But now, as we start stepping into chapter 4, session 5, which I've titled, Come Up Here, because that's Jesus' words. Come, King James, come up hither. Right? Now we're going to look at everything that we just talked about begins to be unveiled with all the workings of the Spirit, with all these different theatrical imageries of all these kinds of things to describe ultimately where we all end. Pastor Karen, would you come, please?
That was so good. See, Buster was prophetic and didn't even know it. Yesterday, he and I were talking about health things, and he sent me this article, and I want to share something with you on cold and hot water. Cold water boosts our circulation and immune system and also helps to detoxify the body. Hot water has a stimulating effect on the body and causes blood vessels to open, allowing better blood flow. It increases oxygen absorption and carbon dioxide excretion, important for detoxification. I found something here I thought was quite interesting. Someone asked a question, why is my water just warm and not hot? In light of what DJ said. Another cause of warm water not being hot is a sediment buildup in the water heater tank. What if we're the water heater tank and there's a sediment buildup in us? That's what I was thinking. Woo! Water that reaches your water heater tank includes dissolved minerals. While the water becomes warmer from the water heater, the debris settles to the bottom of the tank. Water heater burners are on the bottom of the tank. So what if we are those water heaters just causing it to be lukewarm? I thought that was so cool. Thank you, DJ. Because how many of y'all were taught like me that, oh, you want to be hot and not cold? We were all taught that. And when I read it with Francois, it's like the cooling, refreshing waters. Well, yeah, you know. So wasn't that good? Amen. Praise God. So...